Hi friends, welcome to Crack Rugby. We are back with yet another important topic which is very important for your upcoming exam, that is NABARD grade A. But this is not limited to NABARD grade A. This is universal when you see in the context of SEBI grade A and RBI grade B as well. And let me tell you that this topic is not only related to these three examinations. So this is something related to banking awareness, right? So if you are one of the aspirant who is aspiring to give some or the other bank examination, be it the regulatory body or the bank examination, this becomes an important topic, right? So let's begin. Like in every lecture, what we are doing, we are not straight away jumping into what is priority sector, right? So in this lecture as well, we will not straight away jump into what is priority sector. Let us find the reason why priority sector. Let us go back to history, right? So this is the timeline. So let us start with the timeline. So we will start with 1947, then we'll go to 1949, then we will see what happened in 1955, then 1962, then 1967, then 65 to 68. Yes, we are coming back here a bit, but that's fine. I will tell you why we are doing it so. Then we'll go to 1969, then 2007, and then we'll come to the present day. In this timeline, we are going to understand what is priority sector, right? So that we have an overall idea of why this came into existence and the present shape of priority sector, right? Let's begin with what happened in 1947. So I hope this is nothing new. Everyone knows what happened in 1947. India got independence, right? Now let's see what happened in 1949. So two important things happened in 1949. That is, number one, RBI nationalized. And the second thing that has happened is Banking Regulation Act 1949 came into force. The act was enacted by the Parliament of India, right? Then this Banking Regulation Act 1949 provided extensive power to RBI. So before 1949, I mean before Banking Regulation Act, right, RBI was governed by Reserve Bank of India Act, and under the Reserve Bank of India Act, it is a framework of how Reserve Bank of India will function, right? But Banking Regulation Act is like giving the required arsenal to a soldier to fight, right? So Banking Regulation Act gave powers to Reserve Bank of India to carry out the regulatory authority over the entire banking system of the country, right? Then deposit of scheduled commercial bank increased during this time. So once this happens, right, so the deposit goes up. Personal account rose much above the business account. So earlier it was only business account, then by this the personal account came up, right? We will not get deep into all this because this is something related to history. So then in 1955, right, let us come back to 1955. What happened in 1955? State Bank of India stabilized, right? So earlier it was Imperial Bank of India. So once Imperial Bank of India, when Reserve Bank of India was not in existence, the Imperial Bank of India means the parent of the State Bank of India used to function the central banking. They used to act as a central bank for the government of India before Reserve Bank of India came into existence, right? So SBI established in 1955. Then in 1960, SBI Group were created, right? Many banks were named as State Bank of Punjab, State Bank of Patiala, State Bank of Hyderabad, and all they formed as a SBI Group, right? Then what happened? So this, in 1949, remember, RBI got the power. So due to this statutory obligation, many branch opened during that period, right? Second thing, credit to industries increased. Then banks started term lending. So before this, there were term lending, yes, but it was very limited. But now it was expanding, right, in 1955. So let's move forward to the timeline during 1962. Now, what happened in 1962? DICGC established January 1st, 1962. Now, I want you to comment the full form of DICGC. You never know. You can get as simple as they can ask you the abbreviation of DICGC. This was in the recent news. That is the reason I have asked you to write it, right? Okay. So now what happened? To provide some protection to the depositors. So before that, there were no protection even in the nationalized bank, right? So by this act, government tried to provide some protection to the depositors so that people should establish a faith over their deposit, and eventually that faith will be reposed to the entire banking system. So that is the reason this was enacted. Then it enhanced confidence, obviously. Mobilization of deposit started, right? So how does a bank function? Bank is an intermediary, right? Bank do not generate money. They pull the money, they circulate the money. They bring the money from the one hand in terms of saving, they extend the credit on the other hand, right? So they circle the money, right? So mobilization of deposit started during that time in 1962. Now let us move ahead in the timeline and let's see what happened in 1967. So this is one of the important person during that time, right? So in 1967, the Hazari Committee. So Hazari Committee submitted a report called Industrial Planning and Licensing Policy. Right, you don't have to remember this because this is very old. Still, when you write answer for your RBI grade B, you should know all this thing. Submitted its report to Planning Commission on September 14, 1967. You don't have to remember this date, right? September 14, 1967. And in its reports, it said, this is the exact line from the report, right? It would be difficult to undertake credit planning unless the linked control of industry and banks in the same hands is snapped by nationalization of bank. So in 1967, the voice for nationalization was raised by this committee. It had highlighted one of the important aspects, right? So government enacted Banking Regulation Act. It gave power to Reserve Bank of India. SBI Group was formed. Still, government was analyzing that the credit was not flowing down into the economy, right? So this was a huge challenge in front of the government. And this committee highlighted it much well. It said that the people who were managing the bank were the people who were the owners of the industries, right? So eventually the same person is managing the bank and the industry. So the credit that were flowing from the bank were actually not going where it should go. It was going to that industry. So jo bada aadmi hai wo aur bada ho raha hai, gareeb to wahi pe baitha hua hai. So this was the situation back then. So it said, so again I'm reading it just to make you understand. It would be difficult to undertake credit planning. Credit planning means the government plans the credit, that a credit should flow freely down and towards the weaker section in the economy, right? So credit planning, unless the linked control of industry and banks in the same hand is snapped by nationalization of bank, right? Because at that time banks were private. Government did not have, nobody have control over the private. Yes, you can put some regulation, you can put some rules, still you cannot have 100% control or 100% say over something that is private, right? So this committee, right, the Hazari committee has raised a voice in 1967 that it should happen. Now important thing to note here is, during 1967, right? The Prime Minister of India was Srimati Indira Gandhi. The Deputy Prime Minister of India was Sri Morarji Desai, who was also holding the finance portfolio, means he was the finance minister as well, right? So it was during his time in 1967 this has happened. Okay, now let us move little ahead in the timeline. Okay, I meant to say that socialist pattern of the Indian society, right? Now what is socialist pattern? Why do government want to take the credit planning, right? Just because the India is a society that follows socialist pattern. Okay, what is socialist? Jisme sabka bhala ho, jisme sabka bhala ho, everyone should get advantage, everyone should come out of the problems, right? So this is the socialist pattern of the economy. Let's not discuss the socialist pattern into much detail, but aapko ye samajh lo, socialist pattern ka matlab hai जिसमें सबका भला हो. आगे बढ़ते हैं, लेट्स मूव अहेड इन द टाइम लाइन. जस्ट ड्यूरिंग 1965 टू 1968, राइट? इन द लास्ट स्लाइड वी हैव सीन 1967. नाउ विल सी फ्रॉम 1965 टू 68 व्हेन श्री मोरारजी देसाई वॉज द फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर, राइट? मोरारजी देसाई वॉज द फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर एज वेल एज द डिप्टी प्राइम मिनिस्टर ऑफ इंडिया. इन नवंबर 1965, राइट, क्रेडिट ऑथराइजेशन स्कीम वॉज लॉन्च्ड. Okay, later then the scheme of social control over banking was introduced, where banks were asked to pool additional money towards priority sector, right? Look what I told just few minute back, when something is private you cannot 100% enforce something. Okay, you can put some rules, you can put some obligation. That is what RBI and government tried to do it, right? So they introduced a scheme called socialist control over banking, and they have asked bank to pool additional money towards priority sector. ठीक है, उन्होंने बैंकों को बोला कि आप प्रायोरिटी सेक्टर पे लेंड करो, राइट? सिर्फ बोला, नथिंग एल्स. नाउ नवंबर 1968 व्हाट हैपेंस, नेशनल क्रेडिट काउंसिल वॉज फॉर्म्ड विद ए व्यू टू provide a forum for deciding priorities. For deciding priorities. Now you are getting why we were reading all this thing, why we are connecting. So if you learn priority sector lending, I must say that you should know that the first committee or the first step towards priority sector happened in 1968. हाँ, उससे पहले भी हुआ है. इट हैपेंड ड्यूरिंग 1965, बट व्हाट हैपेंड इन 1968, एग्जैक्ट वर्ड इज प्रायोरिटीज. दिस नेशनल क्रेडिट काउंसिल वाज इंटरेस्टेड विद अ टास्क टू डिसाइड प्रायोरिटीज, व्हाट शुड बी द प्रायोरिटी सेक्टर, प्रायोरिटी सेक्टर क्या होगा. आया समझ में? तो दिस इज द फर्स्ट थिंग दैट यू शुड नो व्हेन यू लर्न प्रायोरिटी सेक्टर लेंडिंग, right? Now let us move ahead in the timeline. During 1969, right, 1969 many event happened, so I will relate it to politics as well. See, 19th July 1969, 14 commercial banks with deposits worth 50 crore or more were nationalized. Who was the prime minister then? Srimati Indira Gandhi. Who was the finance minister then? Morarji Desai. What happened during that time is very interesting, right? Srimati Indira Gandhi asks the finance minister to resign, okay? But finance minister, who was also the deputy prime minister of India, so Srimati Indira Gandhi asked him to resign only from the finance portfolio because she wanted to take control of the finance ministry, and asked him to continue as the deputy prime minister of India. But Morarji Desai, on his self respect, he resigned from both of the post and he left Indian National Congress in 1969. Okay, so it is being said that Morarji Desai was not in favor of nationalization, right? I mean, yes, he was in the favor of, that is the reason let's go back to the previous slide. During 1968, National Credit Council was formed. It was the finance minister. So it was happening when Morarji Desai was the finance minister. But in 1969, all of a sudden, 14 commercial banks was nationalized by the then prime minister. But the finance minister left. Now, what was happened there, and what is the detail of why the finance minister left, is not something to study in ESI. That is something related to politics or polity. We are not going to discuss it here. Just I gave you as an information so that it becomes interesting, right? Now, this bank were nationalized. So this is the exact words of the Prime Minister of India, then Prime Minister of India, Srimati Indira Gandhi. What she said, these are the points. Removal of control by few. So this were the reason that she gave for nationalization, right? The first one is removal of control by a few. You got it? I gave you the example of same people who were into the industry, were into the bank board. So the credit was flowing from the bank, but to whom? But to them in the industry, right? So removal of control by a few. Provision of adequate credit for agriculture and small industry and export. Now comes the main thing. Look at this word, agriculture. The priority has been set here. Agriculture, small industry and export. Small industry and export, right? Then giving a professional bent to management. Giving a professional bent to management. Kyunki kya hota tha, the people who were into the industry, they are expertise in their job. But since they have money, they were also into the bank board and they are not the expert in the banking sector, right? So nationalization was done to give a professional bent to the management. Then encouragement of a new class entrepreneurs, right? Then the provision of adequate training as well as terms of service for bank staff. Okay, so there were not many branches, so there were not many rural branches, there were not banking sector was not easily reachable by the rural sector before this. So to overcome all this thing, Srimati Indira Gandhi nationalized 14 banks with deposit worth 50 crore or more, right? And she gave the reason, and mind it, this is the exact words of the Prime Minister, right? Now let's move ahead in our lecture and see what happened in 2007, right? So in 2007, let us look at data. So you don't have to remember this. Why I am giving, to make you understand the impact that has happened from 1969 to 2011. Share of credit for priority sector increased 2,324,058 crores as on March 25, 2011, as against just 23 crore on June 30, 1969. Look, in 1969, given the size of the country like India, the amount was just 23 crore. But by the time it's 2011, it rose to 324,058 crore, right? So it was huge. So yes, if you see, nationalization has helped in many aspect. It has helped increase the branches. It has helped to help the socialist pattern of the Indian society. Now the banking sector is more reachable in the urban and in the rural as well. More and more people are reposing their faith into the banking sector. So nationalization helped in many ways, right? Now let us read this. In an effort to widen and make the directed credit system more effective, the guidelines on lending priority sector were revised on April 30, 2007. The broad category now includes, so in 2007, this were the category. Number one, agriculture. Number two, small enterprise. Okay, let me move this way. Number three, retail trade. Number four, माइक्रो क्रेडिट, नंबर 5 एजुकेशन लोन, नंबर 6 हाउसिंग लोन, राइट। सो इन 2007 दिस वॉज कैटेगराइज्ड। ओके, नाउ लेट्स मूव अहेड इन द टाइम लाइन दैट इज प्रेजेंट डे। सो वॉट इज द स्ट्रक्चर? सो नाउ वी कम इन टू द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ द लेक्चर, प्रायोरिटी सेक्टर। टिल नाउ वी वेर लुकिंग एट हिस्ट्री, वाई प्रायोरिटी सेक्टर। आई होप यू हैव अंडरस्टूड वाई प्रायोरिटी सेक्टर वॉज रिक्वायर्ड, राइट। नाउ लेट अस सी वॉट इज प्रायोरिटी सेक्टर। सो इफ वी सी द कैटेगरी ऑफ PSL, फर्स्ट वी आर गोइंग टू सी कैटेगरीज। सो दिस आर द कैटेगरीज ऑफ प्रायोरिटी सेक्टर लेंडिंग। नंबर 1 एग्रीकल्चर, नंबर 2 माइक्रो स्मॉल एंड मीडियम एंटरप्राइज, नंबर 3 एक्सपोर्ट क्रेडिट, नंबर 4 एजुकेशन, नंबर 5 हाउसिंग, नंबर 6 सोशल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर, नंबर 7 रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी, नेक्स्ट इज अदर्स, राइट। सो वी आर गोइंग टू सी ईच ऑफ देम इन टू डिटेल, बट बिफोर वी गेट इन टू दिस डिटेल वी शुड नो वाई। टिल नाउ वी हैव लर्न वाई PSL, राइट। Now we are going to learn why these sectors, why only these sectors, right? Okay, so let's begin with this C plus I plus G plus X minus M. What is this? So I hope you know your syllabus, right? So national income, and from the chapter of national income, how to calculate the national income, this is one of the method, right? So if you see this method, you will understand, I will correlate why this sectors, right? Now what is C? C is consumption. What is I? Investment. What is G? Government expenses, right? What is X? Export. What is M? Import, right? So this is the formula for calculating national income. Now correlate, if the loan is given to agriculture sector, so still many people in India lives on agriculture, right? So the income that they generate from the agriculture or the agriculture sector, that is their primary source of livelihood, right? So let's suppose I am a farmer, right, and I live my livelihood only by the farming activity, right, or the activity that is related to agriculture. Okay, so what happens when government or bank gives me loan? I can spend it in my farm, right? I can harvest more and more produce, whereas if I don't have money, I will only use one season for harvesting, whereas if I get loan from the bank, I can use 2 or 3 season, right? So yes, then I can use technology to enhance my produce. Okay, and ultimately what is going to happen, my way of style. So what if I earn 100 rupees today, one day with the help of bank, I will start to earn 150, then 200, then 300, something like that, right? So most of the people in India lives on agriculture, right? So if government is giving them loan, right, if government is giving them loan, what the first priority for them would be? To come out of poverty level, and to come out of poverty level, they also know where to spend. Let us not look into different context, right? Just understand, they will spend more money into the farming activities. Consumption will increase, right? Then once they start to generate income out of that loan, they will repay the loan as well, and they will invest in their maybe when they were not having a good or pakka house, we say they will build a pakka house, right? So that will be calculated in investment. So yes, that will come under investment, right? House comes under investment if you build house. So this way agriculture is going to increase the national income. Then, micro, small and medium enterprise. So still in India, there are the contribution of MSME is very high when it comes to as a percentage of GDP. So if you see the contribution of MSME, it's still high, right? And many people gets job from this MSME, right? So MSME, basically, they are not in the urban or metro cities. They are in semi-urban places, in towns and in rural areas, right? So MSME has many importance. First, they contribute to the national income. Second, they provide local job opportunity to the local people. This is most important. Employment is also important. See, if employment increases, consumption will increase, investment will increase, and when this increases, more and more people are into job, government will have to spend more in the social sector, right? So this gives a boost in the national income. But why this is included? Mostly for the reason MSME contributes in the job sector, right? It provides local job opportunity. It generates job in the local or in the small areas, right? Consider एक छोटा सा bakery है, ठीक है? वो भी MSME है, छोटा सा bakery है. They are employing 5 to 10 people. वो bakery है बोल के ही तो वो 5-6 लोगों को काम मिल रहा है ना. Bakery नहीं होता तो उनको काम मिलता? नहीं मिलता. Maybe वो जो 5-6 unskilled लोग हैं, they were maybe they will go to Manrega's for their employment need. Or they will become laborer because they do not have skills, right? So MSME logo ko upskill bhi karta hai aur job bhi deta hai, right? So this way MSME contributes. Then export credit. Export and import is one of the important aspects of any economy, right? Aap apna saman jab tak, dekho, everyone, every business, in some or the other way is related to sales. Be it service also. Service भी बेचना इज ए सेल्स, राइट? सो एवरी बिजनेस सर्वाइव्स व्हेन इट सेल्स देयर प्रोडक्ट और सर्विस और एनीथिंग, ओके? सो एक्सपोर्ट्स. नाउ कंसीडर इंडिया एज ए होल, राइट? इंडिया एज ए होल, एज ए कंपनी. मैं कुछ बनाता हूँ, आप कुछ बनाते हो, और भी ऐसे बहुत सारे लोग कुछ कुछ चीज बनाते हैं, कोई कुछ सर्विस प्रोवाइड करता है. सो नेशन एज ए होल, हमको भी तो सामान बेचना है बाहर के देशों में. दैट इज एक्सपोर्ट, राइट? So when there is no export, there is no inflow or outflow of foreign currency. आप अपना वो कैसे build करोगे, foreign portfolio कैसे build करोगे, right? So export is an important aspect in any economy. Even you can see in the formula, it is there, export. That is the reason this finds a place. Education. Why education is a priority sector? From the starting to still today, एजुकेशन शुड बी प्रायोरिटी सेक्टर. लोगों के पास स्किल्स नहीं रहेगा तो लोगों को जॉब नहीं मिलेगा, राइट? सो देर शुड बी बैलेंस बिटवीन स्किल्स एंड रिक्वायरमेंट, ओनली देन द इकोनॉमी इज गोइंग टू सर्वाइव, ठीक है? जैसे यूजली वी से दैट इंडिया इज बींग गोइंग थ्रू द ब्रेन ड्रेन, सो गुड ब्रेन्स आर गोइंग आउट ऑफ इंडिया. लुक एट सत्य नंदेला, उनको इंडिया में जॉब कहाँ मिलता? ही इज द सीईओ ऑफ माइक्रोसॉफ्ट. सुंदर पिचाई, ही इज द सीईओ ऑफ गूगल. इंदिरा नुई, शी वॉज द सीईओ ऑफ पेप्सिको. सो एंड अगेन आई थिंक सीईओ ऑफ मास्टर कार्ड इज ऑल्सो एन इंडियन. सीईओ एंड कॉग्निजेंट ऑफ इज ऑल्सो एन इंडियन. सो इफ यू सी इन दिस कॉन्टेक्स्ट, यस, ब्रेन ड्रेन इज देयर, स्टिल एजुकेशन इज रिक्वायर्ड. सो एजुकेशन इज अ प्रायोरिटी, राइट? ओनली देन द इकोनॉमी इज गोइंग टू कम अप. जब तक लोग ये नहीं समझेंगे कि मैं क्या करने से मेरा देश आगे बढ़ेगा या मैं आगे बढ़ूंगा, तब तक तो ना उस इंसान का भला हो सकता है ना देश का भला हो सकता है, राइट? सो एजुकेशन इज एन इम्पॉर्टेंट पार्ट. देन कम्स द हाउसिंग. व्हाई हाउसिंग? इन मैनेजमेंट यू माइट हैव लर्न द मास्लोस थ्योरी, राइट? सो लेट्स नॉट डिस्कस द मास्लोस थ्योरी हियर. हिंदी में एक कहावत है, रोटी कपड़ा मकान. मकान इज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग एंड दैट्स ए प्रायोरिटी. Why this is a priority? When one person builds up home, it counts towards investment. It counts towards investment, right? So this is a priority. So I am connecting from this example, right? I am connecting from this national income's formula. Then social infrastructure. This contributes here, government expenses. What is social infrastructure? Roads, bridges, public bus stands, railways, right? Then public drinking water. मैंने जो भी चीज़ लोगों के लिए गवर्नमेंट बना के देता है यूज़ करने के लिए, सो दैट इज़ ऑल टुगेदर दैट कम्स अंडर सोशल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर, राइट? सो दिस ऑल्सो काउंट्स इन हियर गवर्नमेंट एक्सपेंसेस. देन रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी, राइट? व्हाई दिस इज प्रायोरिटी? बिकॉज नॉन रिन्यूएबल एनर्जी इज नॉट इन अबंडेंस, राइट? वन ऑफ द अदर डे इट इज गोइंग टू डिप्लेट. So our dependency should not increase in non-renewable energy. We are already dependent. Not only the entire world is dependent over the petroleum product, right? So they are finding ways. They are moving towards the electric mobility. Still far. The electric mobility is something not coming in the near future. It will take decades to replace the entire petroleum industry, right? So this should be one of the priority, because this is not going to happen in one day. This is very long term process, right? Again, this contributes to X minus M. In Indian context, petroleum product import hum jyada karte hain, bahut hi jyada mein. Now others I won't discuss it here. Let's when we are going to see each of them, we are going to understand what others is, right? So let's begin with agriculture. ओके, सो बिफोर वी बिगिन विद एग्रीकल्चर, लेट अस सी PSL किस पे एप्लीकेबल होता है, राइट? द फर्स्ट थिंग, ऑल शेड्यूल्ड कमर्शियल बैंक एंड फॉरेन बैंक विद साइजेबल प्रेजेंस इन इंडिया. शेड्यूल्ड कमर्शियल बैंक एंड फॉरेन बैंक्स. पॉइंट टू, नोट दिस थिंग, यू विल हैव टू रिमेंबर. देन रीजनल रूरल बैंक, कोऑपरेटिव बैंक्स एंड स्मॉल फाइनेंस बैंक, इनको भी एप्लीकेबल होता है. हाउ मच परसेंटेज? 40% ऑफ देयर एडजस्टेड नेट बैंक क्रेडिट, राइट? सो यू डोंट हैव टू अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट इज एडजस्टेड नेट बैंक क्रेडिट. आई डोंट थिंक दिस इज इंपॉर्टेंट, बट व्हाट यू शुड नो, इट्स 40% ऑफ ANTC, राइट? एंड फॉर रीजनल रूरल बैंक, कोऑपरेटिव बैंक एंड स्मॉल फाइनेंस बैंक, इट्स 75%. The important thing here is to know the percentage. You never know, you will get an objective question where they will ask you what is the percentage share of PSL for small finance bank. The answer would be 75% of ANTC. I hope this is clear. Next, let's move to primary urban cooperative bank. So this is updated very recently. So let's look into it. So total priority sector, it's 40%, we have seen in the last slide. But for UBC, means urban cooperative bank, right? So the target for UBC should increase in a phase wise manner. This is what RBI said. So existing target for them is 40%. March 31st 2021, it is 45%. March 31st, 2022, 50%. Then in 23, March 31st, 23, it would be 60. Then on March 31st, 2024, it would be 75. So what is important here for you is the, sorry, yes. What is important for you is the existing target and when it is going to achieve its upper circuit, that is 75, it would be March 31st, 2024. You never know, you can get an objective, because this was very recent, right? So upcoming examination, this is related to agriculture and related to NAVARD as well. You can expect one or the other objective from priority sector lending and these are some of the important. I will highlight it whenever it comes. I will highlight it more than once so that you do not miss it. You should remember both of the thing. Face wise manner, the upper cap is 75% and it should be completed by March 31st, 2024, starting from 40%, right? Now, let us move ahead in our lecture and let us see each of the sector in detail. First, let us start with agriculture. So, agriculture, the target is 18%, right? So, out of that 40%, the agriculture sector should get 18%. Aa gaya samajh mein? Clear? Okay. A and DC. And again, agriculture sector is divided into three: agriculture credit, agriculture infrastructure, and ancillary activities. Right? Now, let us look at them in detail. Farm credit, the first one. Okay? So, what it says? Look, you don't have to remember all this in detail. You should know that anything that is related to agriculture comes under PSL. Anything. But what you should remember is this green line, because this is newly added, and something like Kisan credit card scheme. So this is important. So the moment you are learning the government scheme, you are learning there that the loan that is given under Kisan credit card scheme comes under PSL. Comes under PSL. So if you are learning it there, it's okay. If you are not learning it there, you should learn here, right? So you don't have to remember everything, but yes, this is important, right? Because Kisan credit card scheme is a government scheme. So the loan that is given under KCC is covered under PSL. I mean, the loan is counted towards the PSL targets. Okay, now this green line is the new one that was introduced, and I will highlight loan against pledge hypothecation of agriculture produce for a period not exceeding 12 months subject to a limit of 75 lakhs again NRW and up to 50 lakh against warehouse receipt then NRW. So this is the new that is included. You should read once or twice, you will get to know. I don't think any of the objective can be formed from this, but you never know. Just remember this 75 lakh against 50 lakh received, right? The next is loan to farmer for installation of standalone agriculture pumps and for solarization of grid connected agriculture pump. Okay, so this also comes under PSL. Now see why this is why I have highlighted it. The reason is everywhere you will see solar schemes is going on, right? So where there is no electricity, farmer is dependent on the sun for its electricity needs, right? So this was long back ago, but now this is becoming very common. Even if they have electricity, they are moving towards solar because the installation is subsidized, right? So I'm not going to discuss that scheme here. So that scheme varies from state to state, right? Like Madhya Pradesh will have a different, Chhattisgarh has a different, Maharashtra has something different. So that varies from state to state. So they are subsidized. So again, the loan given for that purpose also counts for PSL. You got my point? Okay, let's move forward. So this PPT will be there in the description. Download it, study it from here so that I have mentioned everything that is important from the RBI website itself, right? Then let's see the second one for the farm credit. So this was for the individual farmers, right? Now this is for the corporate farmers. Okay, this is for the corporate farmers. So again, there is not much to remember from this, but you should know. Then okay, so yes, I did not mention this is one of the important loans up to 5 crores per borrowing entity FPO FCP undertaking farming assured marketing for their produce at predetermined price. Okay, this is one of the important, and also you should know that urban cooperative banks are not permitted to lend to cooperative of farmer. Means UCBs can lend to individual farmer but not to cooperative farmer. So this is an objective type material, right, which you should know the difference. UCB can lend to individual farmer, UCB cannot lend to cooperative of farmers. Okay, now next we are going to move to agriculture infrastructure, right? So loans under agriculture infrastructure is 100 crore per borrower. That's it. So this is the only thing that you will have to remember from this. Then ancillary service. Now loans up to 5 crore to cooperative societies of farmer for purchase of produce of members. Now you don't have to remember this. The reason I have highlighted this is not applicable to UCB, right? So whenever there is a statement based question, so you can expect this line completely there. This is short line, yes, it can be there, right? So you will have to, so even see, I would not say that this is very important. Again, I would not say that this is not important. This is somewhere in middle between very important to least important, right? Why? Because it is not applicable to UCBs. They have written it. So this line becomes important. Okay, then loans up to 50 crore to startup. So this was not there in earlier. This is newly added as per the definition of Ministry of Commerce and Industry. So startup ka jo definition hai wo kaun deta hai? Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Government of India. So loans up to 50 crore to them will be counted towards the PSL. Okay, and this is one of the important outstanding deposit under RIDF and other eligible funds with NABARD on account of priority sector shortfall. To abhi dekho agriculture pe humne tino dekh liya. Agriculture pe total PSL kitna hai? 40%. And out from that 40%, 18% should go to agriculture sector. Now the thing is, if there is any shortfall, the shortfall should go to RIDF, right? Outstanding deposit should go to RIDF. Okay, now what you need to know about RIDF, I will not discuss. I want you to, if someone writes the meaning of RIDF, that's fine. If not, try to find out and try to learn by own and comment in the comment section. If I find, then we can go ahead and make a video on RIDF, because this is related to NABARD and this is also very important, right? And how does NABARD utilize and redistribute it into the agriculture sector, right? So you will have to know this. So jo bhi shortfall ya deposit, outstanding deposit rahega agriculture sectors ke liye, wo kahan pe chala jayega? RIDF fund mein chala jayega. Rural Infrastructure Development Fund. Okay, I have told you the full form. Now rest you will have to find out. If you cannot find out, comment section pe batao, I will make a video on it, because this is an important topic, right? And how does NABARD use it? Then let's move forward and look at MSME. That's number two. Okay, so 7.5% of ANBC. Agriculture pe kitna tha? 40% ka 18% tha. Total 40% ka 18% tha. MSME pe kitna hai? It's 7.5%, right? 7.5%. Now factoring transactions, this is related to MSME. So the MSME who is into the factoring transaction are eligible to get loan, but not applicable to RRB and UCB, right? So here there are many things that you need to know. What is factoring transaction at the first place? So that is related to finance. I am not going to discuss it in this lecture, but this becomes important because this is not applicable to RRB and UCBs. So this is related to whom then? SBC, foreign bank, and right? Now all loans to unit in the khadi and village industry sectors will be eligible for classification, right? Then loans up to 50 crore to startup that we have seen in the last slide, वो MSME को मिलेगा, agriculture sector के MSME को मिलेगा, ठीक है? Outstanding deposit with SIDBI and Mudra Limited. So यहाँ पे जो भी outstanding means, if a bank is not able to achieve 5%, जो outstanding deposit रहेगा, वो SIDBI और Mudra के पास देना पड़ेगा, ठीक है? On account of priority sector shortfall, किसको देना पड़ेगा? SIDBI और Mudra. Agriculture के 18% पे अगर shortfall रहा, तो कहाँ जाएगा? NABARD के RIDF fund में जाएगा. यहां पे शॉर्टफॉल रहा तो कहां जाएगा? SIDBI एंड मुद्रा लिमिटेड में जाएगा. पॉइंट द डिफरेंस एंड आई मस्ट से दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, राइट, इन टर्म्स ऑफ ऑब्जेक्टिव एंड इवन फॉर योर फेस टू एज वेल. दिस इज वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, कहां का आउटस्टैंडिंग कहां पे जाएगा. ओके, देन लेट्स सी व्हाट्स नेक्स्ट. एक्सपोर्ट क्रेडिट, राइट? सो डोमेस्टिक बैंक incremental export credit over corresponding date of preceding year up to 2% of ANBC, 40 up sanction limit is 40 crore per borrower. So I won't read the entire thing because you need to know that export credit also comes under PSL, that's it. But I don't feel these numbers are important, right? No changes has been done. Then let's move forward, but this doesn't mean that you are not going to read it, right? So this is something least important. You should have a look once or twice so that it is there in your mind. You don't have to mug it up. Then let's move forward in the education. So loans to individual for education purpose, including vocational course, not exceeding 20 lakh will be considered as eligible for priority sector classification. So 20 lakh. Why I have pointed 20 lakh? Because earlier it was some other amount. Now I want you to comment in the comment section what was that amount. You never know, you can get the changes from this to this, the objective, right? Or you can get what was the earlier amount. So possibility of getting the earlier amount is very low. They won't ask you this way. They will ask you, earlier it was this amount and now it has changed to what amount. There will be five options. You will have to select that it's 20 lakh will be considered eligible, right? Loan currently classified as priority sector will continue till maturity. Okay, so at present this is not important. This means that the loan that bank has already given, till they mature they will be considered as PSL. Okay, now let's move forward towards PSL housing. What PSL norms says about housing. Individual loans up to 35 lakh in metropolitan center. Okay, individual loan up to 35 lakh. Loan up to 25 lakh in other center for purchase, construction or dwelling unit per family. This is apart from metropolitan center. Metropolitan matlab Delhi, Bombay, Kolkata, Chennai, right? Big cities. Apart from this, other cities it's 25 lakh. Then loan up to 10 lakh in metropolitan center and up to 6 lakh in other center for repair to damage. ठीक है, किसी का पुराना घर है उसको रिपेयर करना है, डैमेज हो गया है, तो उसमें 10 लाख मिलेगा मेट्रोपोलिटन में, 6 लाख कहाँ के लिए है? अपर लिमिट अलग जगह के लिए. एंड दिस विल बी काउंटेड टूवर्ड्स पी एस एल हाउसिंग. ओके, bank loan to any government agency for construction of dwelling unit or for slum clearance and rehabilitation of slum dwellers subject to dwelling unit with carpet area of not more than 60 square meter. What does this mean? So agar koi state government koi scheme banati hai, like they have a slum in a particular place and they want to remove that slum and build home for those people living in the slum. So for per family, the loan amount would be given if the house that is built is not more than 60 square meter, then the amount can be counted in PSL housing. I hope you got it, right? Then outstanding deposit with NHB. So if there is outstanding deposit for PSL housing, then it will go with NHB, National Housing Bank. National Housing Bank, right? Now Let's move forward in our lecture. Now PSL, social infrastructure, right? So bank loan up to a limit of 5 crore per borrower for setting up of school, drinking water facilities and sanitation facilities, including construction, refurbishment of household toilets and water improvement at household level, etc. And loans up to limit of 10 crore per borrower for including healthcare facilities, including under आयुष्मान भारत इन टीयर टू एंड टीयर फोर सेंटर. ठीक है, तो यहाँ पे इम्पोर्टेंट क्या है, 5 करोड़ लोन मिलेगा सोशल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर सेट करने के लिए, बट हेल्थ केयर अंडर आयुष्मान भारत विल बी गिवन 10 करोड़ पर बॉर्वर. एंड दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट बिकॉज दिस इज इंक्लूडेड वेरी रिसेंटली. ओके, सो एंड सिंस हेल्थ इज ए कंसर्न राइट नाउ, okay, health is a concern right now for the entire world, so anything that is related to health you should know. Yes, if someone wants to set up hospital in tier 2 or tier 4 centers, the loan they can get is rupees 10 crore under PSL social infrastructure. Okay, now in case of UCB, the above limits are applicable only in center having a population of less than 1 lakh. Right, so basically UCBs won't function in metro areas. UCB will only in PSL social infrastructure, UCB the above limits are only applicable when the population of that particular place is less than 1 lakh. Many people are from village, maybe you people are working somewhere in the metro, right? So if your native place has 1 lakh below population, then UCB can do this kind of activities. I mean, they can lend with this limit 5 crore and 10 crore under PSL social infrastructure, else it cannot lend, right? Then let's move forward in our lecture, PSL renewable energy. So bank loan up to a limit of 30 crore to borrower for purpose like solar waste power generator. 30 crore to borrowers for purpose like solar waste water power generators, biomass based power generators, windmills, etc., etc. You see, so 30 crore कोई भी renewable energy को बेच के क्षेत्र में काम करने वाला, anyone working in the area of renewable energy, so the borrower upper limit for them is 30 crore. They can get loan up to 30 crore and that will be counted towards PSL renewable energy. For individual household, the loan limit will be 10 lakh per borrower. Right, and for who is want to do it commercially will be 30 crore per borrower. Okay, now let's move forward. PSL others, this we haven't seen there, we are going to understand it here. What are this? These are not very important, right? But loan not exceeding 1 lakh per borrower. Why I have highlighted this 1 lakh? The amount was different. It has changed, right? So I have highlighted it. This has changed. Borrower provided directly by bank to individual and individual members of SHG, provided the individual borrower household annual income in rural area does not exceed 1 lakh. For non-rural area, it does not exceed 1.6 lakh. So this amount has changed. So this becomes important. ठीक है, ये इंपॉर्टेंट बनता है बिकॉज ये पहले 50,000 था, वो अभी 1 लाख हो गया है. ठीक है, तो ये नवन नो यू कैन गेट एन ऑब्जेक्टिव, राइट? लोन नॉट एक्सीडिंग 2 लाख प्रोवाइडेड डायरेक्टली बाय द बैंक टू एसएचजी फॉर एक्टिविटीज अदर देन एग्रीकल्चर एमएसएमई, राइट? एग्रीकल्चर का तो एग्रीकल्चर में काउंट होगा, एमएसएमई का एमएसएमई होगा. सो अदर देन दिस, लोन फॉर मीटिंग सोशल नीड्स लाइक कंस्ट्रक्शन और रिपेयर ऑफ हाउस, कंस्ट्रक्शन ऑफ टॉयलेट और एनी कॉमन एक्टिविटीज स्टार्टेड बाय द एसएचजी. Right, SHG is a small help group, right? They work in a very small area, in a small cluster, 5 to 6 people, maybe 10 to 12 people. Then they work for a common cause. Some kahin pe there are 5, there are 50 household, right? And there is no toilet, so they will build the public toilet, right? So the loan that they are getting is 2 lakh directly by the bank, okay. Then let's move forward. So you read it. So again, this has come startup, it was there already, so we are not going to discuss. So these two lines become important because the amount has changed in these two lines, okay. So read it twice and thrice, you are going to understand what this is, PSL other. Now PSL weaker section, okay. So this was not there, but still PSL is again there to help the weaker section or the weaker people in the society, okay. So it's 12% of ANBC. So for weaker section, it's 12% of ANBC. Now priority sector loans to the following borrower will be considered under weaker section category. To whom? Small and marginal farmer, artisan, village, cotton industry. So you don't have to remember this, absolutely not required. What is required is 12% of ANBC, okay. 12% of ANBC. Let's move forward. Now adjusting disparity. So this is something new that was released by the RBI in its latest guideline that we are going to see in next two to three minutes. So what is adjusting disparity? To address regional disparity, right? Regional disparity. So I am marking some keywords in the flow of priority sector credit at district level. Okay, it has been decided to rank district on the basis per capita credit flow to priority sector and build an incentive framework for district with comparatively lower flow of credit and a disincentive framework for district with comparatively higher flow of priority sector credit. So basically, isme RBI, what RBI is going to do here is they are going to classify the districts. How? Let's say one district, the PSL amount they have received overall is rupees 100, and on the other district they have received is rupees 50. Okay, so they will find the per capita PSL, means the population of that particular district and population of this district. So they will find the per capita. If it is above, they will disincentivize. Okay, so they will pull the money from there to where it is most required, right? You can see, build an incentive framework for district with comparatively lower flow of credit and disinvestment framework for district with comparatively higher flow of priority sector credit, right? Accordingly, from financial year 2021 onwards, a higher weight, 125%, right? Objective, remember this would be, this can be objective, would be assigned to the incremental priority sector in the identified district where the credit flow is comparatively lower, per capita PSL less than 6000, and lower weight 90% would be assigned for incremental priority sector in the identified district where the credit flow is comparatively higher, per capita PSL greater than 25,000. So the lower limit is set to 6,000, the upper limit is per capita, upper limit is 25,000, right? So this is how they will adjust the disparity, right, between 6,000 to 25,000. Now there is a question for you. The question is, you will have to find the district with higher per capita PSL and lower, low. So what is the name of this district and what is the name of this district? Comment in the comment section, right? In 2 days we are going to update the answer, okay. Do follow us our channel, we will update it in the community section, the answer to this question, right? So let me clear out the question. The RBI has given the list of district, right? तो उसमें से एक डिस्ट्रिक्ट ऐसा है जो टॉप में है. टॉप में क्यों है? बिकॉज द पर कैपिटा पी एस एल इज हाई इन दैट डिस्ट्रिक्ट. सो वॉट इज द नेम ऑफ दैट डिस्ट्रिक्ट, राइट? एंड अगेन देर इज ए लो, ओके, सबसे नीचे वाला. सो नीचे वाला क्या है? वो कौन सा डिस्ट्रिक्ट है, राइट? लाइक आई हैव सीन फॉर माई डिस्ट्रिक्ट. माई डिस्ट्रिक्ट इज एट नंबर 78, ओके. सो यू विल हैव टू सी you will have to find the district with highest per capita flow of PSL and the lowest per capita flow of PSL, and comment in the comment section. We'll update the answer in 2 days in the community section of our YouTube channel. Then let's move forward. Monitoring PSL targets, right? How do RBI monitors PSL target? So the compliance is, they do it on a quarterly basis. This is an objective question, nothing else is important here. How frequent RBI does it? It's quarterly, right? Then non-achievement of PSL target. क्या हो जाएगा अगर कोई बैंक PSL target नहीं मेट करेगी? तो हमने देख लिया ना, अगर outstanding deposit है, ठीक है, तो हम agriculture का कहाँ दे देते हैं, means bank कहाँ देते हैं, गूगल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर डेवलपमेंट फंड दैट इज बिंग मैनेज बाई नाबार्ड, उनको दिया जाता है. MSME में है तो किन को दिया जाता है? मुद्रा को दिया जाता है या सिडबी को दिया जाता है, राइट? सो दिस इज हाउ यू शुड कोरिलेट, यू शुड अंडरस्टैंड. नाउ नॉन अचीवमेंट ऑफ PSL टारगेट, बैंक हैविंग एनी शॉर्टफॉल इन लेंडिंग प्रायोरिटी सेक्टर शैल बी एलोकेटेड अमाउंट्स टू कॉन्ट्रीब्यूशन टू RIDF Established with NABARD and other funds with NABARD, NHB, housing पे कुछ है तो वो NHB को जाएगा, CDB और मुद्रा को MSME वाला जाएगा, as decided by the Reserve Bank of India from time to time. So there is nothing fixed, okay? RBI will decide it time to time. और इसमें जो interest भी मिलेगा बैंकों को, that again Reserve Bank of India decides from time to time, okay? That is not important interest, but from which sector the amount flows to which fund, so that is important. Right, for from agri it flows to RIDF, for from MSME, right, from MSME it flows to SIDBI and Mudra, then for from housing it flows to NHB, right? Now the question is, how do they use it? We are learning PSL, right? And we should also know if any amount that is outstanding in agriculture sector, if it is going in RIDF, how would NABARD use it for the developmental cost, for the cost of development? How will SIDBI and Mudra use it? How will NHB use it, right? Do let me know in the comment section. If you do not find the answer because this is very small, let me know, I'll make a video as well. Now what is the latest update regarding PSL, right? So the latest update regarding PSL is September 4, 2020, right? These were the 5 points that RBI has said. To address regional disparity in the flow of credit sector, higher weightage that district, just I told you just now, the target prescribed for small and marginal farmer in weaker section are being increased in phased manner. 50,000 maine bataya tha, 50,000 se 1 lakh ho gaya, wo aapko yaad rakhna hai. This one, higher credit limit is specified for farmer produce organization. Ek jagah pe humne FPO ka dekha hai, green color ka line, if you remember it, or go back to reverse the video and watch that, what there's phase once, you will understand, right? So this is important. Then loan limits for renewable energy have been increased, doubled. Renewable energy wale field pe bhi maine mark kiya tha, to wo aapko yaad karna hai. For improvement of health infrastructure, credit limit for health including those under Ayushman Bharat has been doubled. Theek hai, yahan pe bhi maine mark kiya tha, kitna tha? It was 10 crore I guess, right? So reverse the video and watch all this. This all are important because this is the latest update from the Reserve Bank of India in 2020, right? So again, this is not all inclusive lecture for the PSL, right? There are many things regarding PSL. Do let me know in the comment section if you find that I have missed something here. I will update the video. I mean, there will be part 2, right? Still I am planning to bring out the part 2. But let me know in the comment section, right? So that we can have a conversation of what you think of this lecture. Then with this, we have come to the end of this lecture. With this, I would like to say, please visit our website, that is www.crackgreenp.com, and you can find one of the most economical course that is available in the country through CreditGrade B. Is RBI grading, SEBI grading, IRD assistant manager, NABARD grade AB, FSAI technical officer, and UPSC EPFO enforcement officer examination. Okay, then it's time to say goodbye. Before I say goodbye, let me say the upcoming examination is the NABARD grading and the NABARD grade D. Anytime the notification is expected, right? You can find the course only for rupees 2499 for grade A and 3499 for grade B. This is one of the most economical and best course available to you for NABARD grade A and NABARD grade B. With this, let me end the lecture and thank you and happy learning. Do subscribe to our channel and remember to answer those questions that I have asked. You will get an update after 2 days. Goodbye.